This was some interesting stats, right? Yeah. I hope that's going to inspire all of us as I take you through a small journey to a few points that I want to stress. Okay, so basically what's happening is all of us in this room have got a mobile phone right now, and we're always communicating with our mobile devices each and every time of the day, each and every time of the night. And what's happening now is Africa has met a revolution, an evolution. I don't call it a revolution. I call it an evolution, as in we're changing the way we live because of the mobile device that we have in our hands. So what's happening from the picture, you can see there's a guy sitting on a camel in the middle of maybe the desert somewhere, maybe in Sahara desert somewhere there, but he's also able to communicate maybe with a lady down here in Zimbabwe, and they're having a chat. So the mere fact that we now live in a ubiquitous society where we're communicating each and every day of our lives, and that has created a lot of opportunities, one, a lot of confusion also, and a lot of challenges, which I take as opportunities. So moving on a bit is, you can see that even the way we perceive technology, the people we live around us, the animals we live around us, I think they've also been influenced a little bit by technology. So that's when you can see the impact of the mobile technology. I guess if you can leave your cell phone down, lying somewhere down, where you've got like a monkey or a baboon, they might make a plan and say, oh, what's up? That kind of thing. Because they're now getting used to the fact that they've seen many people holding cell phones on their ears. And now, due to the fact that from observation, animals also learn. So the mere fact that our lives are changing because of this. And why am I speaking about this? It's the fact that even our children's lives are changing. Our personal lives are changing. And what impact does that have on the future and the current state we have today? So a lot of internet access, telecommunications infrastructure has been happening over the last, I think for Zimbabwe, the last 3 years have seen some significant strides towards that. I'm happy that I got the Broadcom guys around here. They've offered us some cool internet around here. And all this has come at a cost initially and is also at a service to the people. And now the issue that always comes to mind is, okay, we've pumped in all those billions in fiber connecting to the Seacom cable, connecting to Europe. Then what next? Are we going to watch as we lose out all our data from Africa to all those parts of the world through those cables that we all celebrate today? That's the question I'm posing out to you. And the second thing I'm posing out to you is, do we have the skills that are required to actually take advantage of this technology? Because that's the most important part that we have to gauge, that as we opened our borders with those cables to the whole world, we're no longer competing as Zimbabweans, but we're competing as a globe. So we have to change our mindset, per se, that we have to look global. Because if I'm going to make a product which is going to go on my mobile phone, I have to make it in such a way that a person sitting in India, in Delhi, in the Mumbai shanty towns, is able to also say there's an Oswald sitting in Zimbabwe, in Gutu, where I come from, who's doing something cool. So that's the perspective that I'm trying to drive at. And what I'm trying to talk about, and what I'm going to talk about in the next few minutes, is basically compounded by the fact that we've seen mobile technology grow, we've seen a lot of developments coming up, but are we ready for mobile technology is the question. And what skills and what innovation can we bring about through that? I'll take you to this very wonderful class. Everyone has sat on such a desk at one point in their lives. I sat on such a desk like 15, 16 years ago, I believe. So what happened on this desk? Well, my teacher was sitting in front saying, oh, kids, okay, hold on to this pen, draw a picture, read a book, and all that culture. So that was the culture then. We all became what we are today because of what those teachers taught us on those same desks. And that's why we are very competitive in this day and age, because we went through those small books there into bigger, bigger books. We met technology along the way, right? Because we didn't meet technology at this age in our generation. But now what's happening is, in this new generation, the kids are meeting technology at a very, very young age. I got a friend who was a kid. I think he's a two-year-old kid. You'd agree that 2-3 years ago, kids who are 2 years old, when they check out your phone, they would go like this, right? But these days, they go like this. Why? Because they're touch screens, right? So things have changed. Do we all agree on that? So what's happening is, kids of today have got access to technology. But do the teachers of today have access to technology in order to teach the kids of today who've got access to technology is the question that I pose to you guys. So we have to marry those two, right? We have to get the teacher ready for the student. And the student of today, as I say, that two-year-old kid, when she gets to five, she's going to be able to use an iPad. And the teacher that is going to teach that kid is the same teacher that taught me to draw on a chat. Are they going to communicate? Is the question. So you find the fact that when I talk of skills development, with the technology perspective, is the perspective whereby technology has now become pervasive and is very present in our lives, in our children's lives. But are our kids ready, or our teachers ready, and are our parents also, because my dad can't use an iPad. My dad only writes messages and answers the phone and phones. But if I were to tell him, go on the internet and actually reply my email, we could communicate effectively, but we can't do that because he's not proficient in that. So you find that, are the parents also ready for their kids who can use an iPad? So now the issue of skills development comes to be a holistic problem that we need to address in the technology space, where the parents have to take the stage, the teacher has to take the stage. As a government, as a system, we also have to embrace these changes that are happening and also advance modern education spaces similar to this, where you've got people getting access to computers, kids learning how to type at tender ages, because that's going to make them competitive for the global picture that I mentioned earlier on. I believe kids of today need to have critical thinking skills. And they have to solve real problems, because we created a mess. All of us here, we created a mess for our kids, right? So they have to sort out the problems later on. And they have to be creative in solving those problems. So you find that these spaces that we have today have to have the tools in order to initiate or foster creativity. I watched a video recently of a guy called Sugata Mitra. He's from India. I guess some of you guys might have heard about him. He's got an experiment he did where he just put technology in front of young kids without explaining anything. And kids taught themselves how to use that technology. Isn't that wonderful? Some of us would have generally let go of that, continued what we're doing, because we don't want to change, right? But those kids are able to change because they're young, dynamic, and they're very crazy about whatever they see in their lives. So this is basically the idea that I'm saying, that let's create those spaces where creativity, critical problem solving, and the critical thinking part of creativity comes in. So you find that, I'm so happy to see this. I think this is a Zimbabwean project that happened recently. Is it Zikwa Trust? This is a very good initiative. I support this. And I'll actually foster all you guys to rally behind this, because this is the future. If those young kids can be able to use these computers at a tender age and actually be able to compete and design applications and products that serve the problems we have in Africa, let's not forget that part. Let's not just design stuff for the coolness of it. In Africa, cool is not really cool, right? Because if I tell my dad you're doing something cool, he might not understand what you're talking about. But if you tell your dad who's in the States, he says, ah, that's cool, my son, right? So now, with that in mind, we need to have products that speak to the problems we have in Zimbabwe today, in Africa today, in the developing world today. So the moment we have our kids developing applications in health, applications in service delivery, on their mobile phones, because let's agree on one thing. You saw the stats I showed you. There are some kids who never see a computer in their lives. They will see a mobile phone. Because the power of the mobile phone is now competing with the power of a computer a very few years ago, right? I got that Galaxy thing. That thing has got like 1 gig. RAM on that. And a computer, some people sit on computers in their offices with 1 gig RAM. So it means you're equally competing in terms of the random access memory with that device. But I hold it in my hands. You can hold your computer in your hands, can you? So you find that that's the realm of lifestyle. Oh, that's a cool one. I love that. So now, looking at now the fact that, okay, which are the skills that your daughter needs for the future if we're going to move into a technology-oriented environment? I'm lucky enough to have been a person who's crazy about science. And I'm in the engineering space, telecoms specifically, and I work with sensors. If you look at my profile on that book, I like what is called the Internet of Things, where we're going to connect every device on Earth and actually get intelligence out of it. That's what I'm dreaming of right now. So now what's happening is, this guy, I took a picture of a teacher. He's actually teaching maths. I know a lot of guys hate maths around with a passion, right? So what's happening is those are the skills that are required in technology. You need math, you need science, you need business science, you need information science, where people are going to get that information we have and convert it to value. And those skills are fostered in universities, in high schools, and in all the homes that we have. It's unfortunate that when we groom our children, we always like, what do you want to become in life? I want to be a doctor, I want to be a nurse, I want to be a teacher. But today some kids are going to say, no, Dad, I want to be a businessman. Okay, what type of businessman? Are you going to be on the streets, hooking around, making a plan? Or are you going to be a real business plan? So if you're going to be a real businessman in the technology space, these are the skills you need to be the next Mark Zuckerberg. Are we together on that? Because we need another Facebook from Zim. Actually, not a Facebook. We need a better product than Facebook from the Zimbabwean kids, right? That's what we're here for, right? I don't think we're here for something small, right? Okay, we move on. This is where I belong. This is my hub. This is where I stay 24/7 sometimes. This is a lab in Stellenbosch. So what happened is, this is a very peculiar relationship that happens within a business and education system. What happened is the University of Stellenbosch teamed up with a company called MIH. It's a very global, a big company with operations across the globe. So what happens is they created a lab as a space for innovation. So what happens is they get master students, PhD students, and then we come and we sit in this lab. What do we do there? We play games, obviously. Games are cool. I love playing games from time to time. But the good thing about games, it teaches you strategy. It teaches you how to think, problem solving. You get what I'm saying? So if you play Pac-Man, I know everyone knows Pac-Man, right? So if we play Pac-Man here, your kid from a tender age, if he's good in Pac-Man, he's going to understand that when you eat those bullets, you have to run away from Blinky Blink, right? That's how it is. So the mindset is what we're trying to foster around here. So what's happening here is, this lab is resourced enough from the strategic business partner we have. We've got cool computers. I've got one of the best computers you can even imagine. I'm sitting on something like, I think 16 gigs of RAM with an i7 or something like that. That's a cool, because I do some simulations that require that. So what happens is, all those guys here, they're doing a lot of other courses. As you can see, there's gaming, there's internet TV. So this is futuristic. We talk of security because our cell phones are going to be having challenges of security in the future. So that's what we're trying to do in this lab. But what I like about this lab is the fact that a university has teamed up with a strategic business partner to foster what I call creative thinking spaces. Because these spaces are the ones where innovation comes together. Today, this is a space, this is another creative thinking space. If we leave this place without any solutions or identifying problems, I think we've failed. So this is one of the mottos of this lab, that we're creating a thinking space where people are interacting, innovating in different fields, get that right. I talk to guys who develop games. I talk to guys in e-commerce, but we're all in one lab. I do sensor networks. These guys do their own stuff, but we merge somehow in this thinking space. Okay, now I leave the kids' stuff. And actually, I leave the part where we talk of grooming the talent and getting the talent ready for the real world, which is the innovative world. I think you guys have seen this head that has been created by those devices. That's Steve Jobs there. That's one guy that I give respect to, although I don't like a Mac, but I give respect to him. Specifically because he's managed to change the whole landscape of how we view technology. And his company is now, I think, the world's largest company, the world's the richest company in the world right now. You know, all companies have been what? They've been very active, I would say. So what's happening? This guy created all these devices in his lifetime. How many people have even created a device? None of us, right? So what's happening is, this guy saw the loopholes in the whole system and the human need of technology, and he addresses our need. Everyone with an iPhone would actually confirm today that it's a cool device. You just slide, things happen. Ooh, when we were growing up, no one even thought you could punch a button and something would come out, right? Because that was how we grew up. But now our kids, as I say, that two-year-old, she's actually checking out the slide, that she can extend the view and everything. So those are the guys who spearheaded the innovation. So when I moved down to Africa now, that's a world global view of innovation. Africa, there are two cases that I took today. You look at your right side, there's a guy from Malawi. That guy created a windmill in the village. I think you've heard the story of this guy. He took a bicycle cradle. Ain't that cool? He used what he had in front of him, which was cheap material, an old bicycle, and he generated electricity. But what do you want to do? We want to go buy generators, right? That's cool also. But this guy made a plan with what he had, and that's innovation within the African space. He solved a problem that we inherit in Africa. We got M-Pesa. I think you saw the stats from that side. This is a very cool mobile banking application. We all keep our money under the bed, some in the pockets and everywhere. But those guys created a system whereby remittances of cash are effectively happening within the Kenyan space. And people are sending money from all over the world. But this only worked very well in Africa. If you read any journal, any book on mobile banking in this world, which doesn't mention M-Pesa, that guy should actually not write anything. Why? Because this is a true example of a success story which happened in Kenya. And all journals, all economics books, they refer to this. And I take this as an inspiration, say, guys, if the Kenyans did it, Zimbabweans are smarter, right? So can't we do this? Can't we be better than this, is the question. Can't we come up with something that puts us on a global level? Because I think every time everyone says Zimbabweans are clever, wherever I go, Zimbabweans are clever. But what are we doing with our intelligence to give something that shows the whole world that we can do something? That's what I'm calling for today. So now, you look, this is what happens in Africa. Africans think unique. So now, in summary, basically, this is just to show you that Africans use a traditional mobile phone to run a gig. This never happens anywhere in the world. It's only unique to Africa, right? And if you look, these are the hanging fruits I'm talking about. The technology is the hanging fruit in Africa. So what do? We use technology in health, technology in government, technology in schools. Let's change this whole landscape through mobile technology. And if you look at, these are some of the labs in Kenya that they are setting up, the thinking space idea that I have. And the mere fact that you got those thinking spaces, and these are the guys, the role model part. Let's have role models in Zimbabwe who can take us to this level. Let's be the role models of the change for our kids for the future. Let's not think about ourselves. That's being selfish. What is going to happen 30 years down the line? And basically, as a closing statement, I would say that, what is the future of Zim? So today, when we leave this place, I'll call on the technology side. I'm here. I'm there to make it happen if anyone wants to partner with me on this journey. So what I'm saying is, let's create the thinking spaces where we can force the critical thinking and problem solving within the technology space should be in Zim right now. And we should also take Zimbabwe on Africa, on the world level. So, yeah.